They are simple. Let the men rest 3 hours longer. At 1 o'clock the advance guard will march under our command, with Pouton of Saint-Tré as second. The second division will follow at 2 under the lieutenant-general. Keep well in the rear of the enemy, and see to it that you avoid an engagement. I will ride under guard to Beaugency, and make so quick work there that I and the Constable of France will join you before dawn with his men." She kept her word. Her guard mounted, and we rode off through the puttering rain, taking with us a captured English officer to confirm Joan's news. We soon covered the journey, and summoned the castle. Richard Guertin, Talbot's lieutenant, being convinced that he and his 500 men were left helpless, conceded that it would be useless to try to hold out. He could not expect easy terms, yet Joan granted them nevertheless. His garrison could keep their horses and arms, and carry away property to the value of a silver mark per man. They could go whither they pleased, but must not take arms against France again under 10 days. Before dawn we were with our army again, and with us the constable and nearly all his men, for we left only a small garrison in Beaugency Castle. We heard the dull booming of cannon to the front, and knew that Talbot was beginning his attack on the bridge. But some time before it was yet light, the sound ceased, and we heard it no more. Guertin had sent a messenger through our lines, under a safe conduct, given by Joan, to tell Talbot of the surrender. Of course this poursuivant had arrived ahead of us. Talbot had held it wisdom to turn now and retreat upon Paris. When daylight came, he had disappeared, and with him Lord Scales and the garrison of Meung. What a harvest of English strongholds we had reaped in those 3 days, strongholds which had defied France with quite cool confidence and plenty of it until we came. End of chapter 29.